the stakes are very high in what we do, and that the decisions that we make are profound decisions that have lasting impact for us and for the people around us.
If an officer shoots a suspect in the course of his job and the person dies, it's still considered a homicide.
Police officers have a very unique job. They go out and risk their life doing it, and then after they have done it and done it well, they have now become a de facto suspect in a felony crime.
It's important for the public to understand the way our system is structured and what the dynamic is in officer-involved shootings.
When I first started working with police officers involved in shootings, there were things I began to notice right off the bat, even though I really didn't know a whole lot about police operations. As I would talk to the many officers involved in these events, follow them through the investigations, follow them through the media response and the community questions, some things became clear. One is that we were expecting these events to defy the laws of physics. We were expecting these officers to defy the limits of human performance. We often expect them to have a perfect memory and make perfect decisions, when in fact research clearly shows that human beings are not capable of either one of those things, that the training and the judging of police officers is frequently based on myths, assumptions, and personal opinions that necessarily may not be true.
We've become such a video culture, and we rely on what we see in TVs and movies to such a great extent, often without even really being aware of it. There's a tremendous amount of misinformation out there, and to the extent that the public has that as context, it makes it very difficult for them to evaluate whether an officer has behaved appropriately in a use of force application.
This is a difficult thing for the agencies to overcome, trying to explain these events to the world at large who've been trained by Hollywood rather than what really happens.
Most officer-involved shootings unfold rapidly, very rapidly. In fact, our research tells us, and we've got video after video of officers being shot in a real-world encounter, that the threat can unfold as rapidly as a quarter of a second or less, and that is faster than any human being can react to a visual stimulus.
In officer-involved shootings, we have to never forget that it is literally the offender that calls the shots. Officers or anybody who is reacting to what another person is doing is always going to be behind the time curve.
Anyone who is assaulting an officer can assault them faster than they can react. Even if you're prepared, you understand it's about to happen, you can't deal with this type of speed of an encounter.
Patrol officers often are put in a reactionary mode because they're responding to a course of events or they're responding to a person's behavior. Because of the inherent delay involved in the action-reaction dynamic, an officer is already put at a disadvantage.
Unlike the offender, the officers also have to be concerned about the public safety. So they are checking for their environment, checking for bystanders, and being concerned about their own personal safety. The offender is focused on one thing: can I assault this officer and get away with it?
Officers bring a number of tools in their toolkit to a conflict situation. And one of those tools is good communication skills, and in particular, persuasion.
Most of the time, officers do, in fact, talk the person down. If you look at the research, only about 1% of all police calls for service result in any use of force at all. And of course, only a very small percentage of those actually result in the use of deadly force. So in 99% of the cases, officers are able to resolve situations peacefully.
And because of chemical issues, emotional issues, sometimes a variety of other elements, the person is unwilling or unable to listen to anything that the officer says. That means they're in control of the situation. They're the actors, the officer's a reactor, and the officer then has to respond to what the person is doing.
So not all offenders can be stopped, not all offenders can be talked out of what they're getting ready to do, and sometimes it just happens, regardless of what the officer is going to do. At that point, the only thing that the officer can do is use force in an attempt to protect his life and protect the public.
It's not the officer's choice, usually, not to use verbal skills. It's the person being unable to listen or to attend or unwilling to what the officer is saying. Some people think that an individual who's armed with a knife is not a dangerous threat to an officer. And from our research, and certainly the research of others, we know that not to be true. Knives can actually be more dangerous than a gun. They don't have to be reloaded. They can be used at close distance. From our research, we know that a young person and someone who's in reasonably good shape can cover as much as 31 feet in the time span it takes an officer to draw a gun, point, and fire one round. Now, if the person is 7 feet away, the officer could even have the gun out in a low ready position. But by the time they raise the gun and fire, even once, they would be stabbed. And we know that a stab from a knife or a stab or a cut can be extremely quick. And each of those cuts or slashes can occur at less than a quarter second per stab. And any one could be dangerous, could be lethal to the officer. Well, certainly there's a variety of less lethal munitions that an officer can bring to a situation, whether it be beanbags, sponge rounds, tasers, even impact weapons. And the idea is that these are all good tools, and they've got their place in an officer's repertoire or toolkit, but they should not be used in a deadly force encounter.
Police are trained not to kill people, not to taser people. They are trained to stop the threat. And unfortunately, use of less lethal and lethal force does not automatically result in stopping the imminent attack.
So officers do have an obligation to assess the situation and to use the appropriate levels of force so that it doesn't put themselves in any greater jeopardy, or other officers who are with them, or civilians who are nearby, or the community at large in general.
One of the things that I remember seeing on TV back in the days when I watched my cowboy heroes was I watched a Lone Ranger and Roy Rogers and Gene Autry shoot the gun out of somebody's hand or shoot the knife out of their hand. And what we know from a dynamic real-world encounter is an officer is, for the most part, unable to do that, either whether it's shooting a knife or a gun out of the hand, shooting someone in the arm, or even shooting them in the leg. Officers do not have the capability of firing accurately and hitting accurately in a dynamic encounter. And so it's an unimaginable challenge that we're facing officers with if we make them shoot the gun or the knife out of the hand or shoot to wound. It just can't happen. It's one of those Hollywood myths that Hollywood likes to perpetrate, looks good on film, doesn't work in the real world. Even if we aim for center mass, we tend not to be as accurate as we might on the range, because the dynamics of an encounter and the dynamics by which people move in real-world deadly force encounters are such that center mass is a constantly changing target. So it's the best place an officer can aim for. The best chance that they can hit someone is if they aim center mass. But even then, it's not guaranteed. But it's a lot better than trying to aim for a hand or an arm. I was investigating a shooting in which an officer fired four rounds. The officer, like just about every other officer in North America, can fire using their semi-automatic handgun in a quarter of a second per round. So by time I say 1,000 N, this officer's fired four rounds. Now in that time span, the subject who had just begun to step forward toward the officer and was shot and then fell through the plane of gunfire in this fashion was shot from the front and side and then the back and side. Now certainly it looked like the officer shot him in the back, and it was very true, the shots did go into the back. But in the time span it took the officer to fire and for the subject to fall through the plane of fire, there was nothing that the officer could have done to have stopped shooting the subject in the back in that three quarters of a second. So the officer was still shooting to save his life, but the subject was moving and falling. People tend to think that a video is an accurate reporter of any particular incident. But I would like you to look at the number of cameras that are necessary for referees to look at during any football game. The more cameras they have and the more angles they can see things from, the better their judgment is about whether or not the action that they're judging is portrayed accurately and completely. So we know that one video camera from a particular perspective is very limiting in its ability to see anything. Even, for instance, there's a camera that officers are wearing that sits just in front of the officer's ear. And this is reportedly has the view of the officer. It does not. If you close your left eye, for instance, you will see what your right eye sees. And your right eye sees a different field of view than your left eye. And your body links both of those. Now imagine you're a camera far behind your right eye. What is that seeing? That's seeing what's directly in front of the face, not even what the right eye is seeing. It certainly doesn't show the field of view on the left. No camera records things as an officer's eye and brain is recording it that's really embedded in the situation. Just as a quarterback is seeing the different field of view than the viewer is sitting at home watching the camera capture the action on the football field. An officer-involved shooting is a tragedy. It's always a tragedy. It's a tragedy for the deceased. It's a tragedy for the family, friends, loved ones of the deceased. It's a tragedy for the officer. Officers don't want to have to shoot people. They don't want to have to kill them. They will do so if needed. That's part of the job requirements. But it's a tragedy for them too, because they could face prison, ruin, they could lose their job. A civil suit is not unusual in officer-involved shooting cases. It's tough for an officer. It's tough for them to take someone's life. More importantly, they will likely shoot to save their life. And it's usually surprising, if not really traumatic for an officer, to come face to face with their own death. Most of us never do that.
The stress of these events can happen within a 3 to 5 second period, which is the time of the actual event itself. But any officer involved in this will tell you that by far the most stressful part of the event is everything that happened afterwards. And that's why it's really important that we do a lot of research and be very careful that our investigations of these events provide a fair, neutral, objective, and fact-finding investigation that will educate everybody, the public, the agency, and the officers, about what really happened so that we can have a successful outcome.
Several years ago, the Oregon legislature created Senate Bill 111, and that provided a general structure that allowed each of the counties to then create plans within that structure for the processing of officer-involved shootings. Lane County was among the first in the state to put together a protocol consistent with Senate Bill 111 for processing of officer-involved shootings and also the required public outreach that should happen on an annual basis. Our protocol created an IDFIT team, and that stands for Interagency Deadly Force Investigations Team. And that's a multi-agency team where the police agencies each contribute a member or two members, typically, to participate in the investigation, with the lead on the team either being the county sheriff or the state police, depending on whether one or the other is involved in the shooting. The idea is to have the principal agency or the lead agency be not involved in the shooting, so the public understands that there is an impartial investigation taking place. The protocols have allowed for a systematic review. That's the whole idea, is to have a process that's followed in every case and one which the public can have some faith as being conducted in an impartial and systematic manner.
Yeah, it's our job as the IDFIT team to conduct an investigation and to bring those facts to the DA's office. It's the DA's office's job to make a decision on whether or not the shooting was justified and the use of force was appropriate. And then it's the officer's agency that's involved, its job to decide whether or not policy and procedure were followed properly for their particular agency.
The most time-consuming portion of the process is the evidence gathering. That's talking to witnesses, reviewing videotape if there is any, gathering all of the evidence and sort of digesting it into police reports. which are all then packaged and presented to the DA.
The ITFIT team itself makes it very easy to accomplish these tasks, because when we were individual agencies, we didn't have the resources to get a lot of these things done in a timely manner. With the team bringing in 12 detectives from 4 or 5 different agencies, it brings us so many resources in such a short period of time. It allows us to get a lot of this stuff done quickly and real efficiently. Yeah, I understand it's frustrating for the media and the public when we don't provide the information that they're looking for. And it's, in all honesty, it's frustrating for us too, because we want to be able to tell you what happened, especially if it's an officer who's done something outstanding, saving somebody's life. But just to keep the integrity in the investigation and to make sure that nothing's tainted, we hold on to that information.
Sometimes in these situations, officers are forced to work on a limited set of facts, and they're forced to make quick decisions that have huge ramifications with a very short amount of time and a limited set of facts. And officers are trying to make those decisions as best they can.
I hope that people will understand that police operations are very complicated, very difficult. Sometimes they're very hard to understand. Obviously, when a member of the community is hurt, it's understandable that people become emotional about that. And the most important message I want to give to everyone is that we need to refrain from a rush to judgment, that things may not always be as they appear. And we want people to give the officers, these are public servants, good men and women doing a very difficult job, and the least that we can do is provide them the benefit of the doubt while the investigations are going on.